Good evening. My name is Scott Harris. I'm Executive Director of the University of Mary Washington Museums. And it's my pleasure to welcome both our audience here in Monroe Hall on the campus of the University of Mary Washington and those joining us by means of technical processes which will be somewhat difficult to explain to our guests this evening, so I'll just pass over that. We're very grateful for the opportunity to have a conversation this evening with the wives of two of the presidents of the United States who not only brought credit upon the nation, but particularly upon the Commonwealth from which they originated here in Virginia. I'm speaking of Mrs. Dolly Madison, wife of our fourth president, James Madison, and Mrs. Elizabeth Monroe, the wife of our fifth president, James Monroe. Now, a word to our audience, just as a reminder to you, because there's a lot going on in life, and you may have forgotten that today, as we sit here and have this conversation, it is in fact March 2nd, 1818. No, your calendars are not wrong. That is really the day. It is March 2nd, 1818. And we hope that everyone will remember that as we forge ahead with our discussion with these two ladies. Ladies, welcome.
Thank you.
A delight to be able to speak with you this evening. And we hope you will find it an experience that's both enjoyable and perhaps enlightening for yourselves as well as those who are with us this evening.
I think we're all eagerness.
Indeed. Well, something that maybe right at the outset would be interesting to address. I know it's been a topic in society, perhaps, maybe amongst yourselves. By the time Mr. Monroe commenced his administration that he is now in 1817, following his election in 1816 and then beginning his administration, although we have pretty well figured out how to address the president with Mr. President, perhaps His Excellency, I'm not sure that a form of address appropriate to the station of the wife of the president has really come about. And we do wonder if either of you ladies have any thoughts on what a proper mode of address would be for you in the role that you have had or do have now.
Well, I, Mrs. Monroe, I have not considered the matter very much. I know that sometimes, you know, it's Lady Presidentress. I believe that Lady Washington started, you know, being agreeable to being addressed by that name. I don't know how much her wishes played into it, but certainly a gentlewoman. And I don't know what Mrs. Adams called herself. Do you recall? I do not have the pleasure of her acquaintance, but Lady Presidentress, I find it a little awkward to say, so thank heavens I don't have to call anyone else that. I'm always very happy just to be Mrs. Madison, and let's see, I've heard rumors that some people in the Federal City call me Queen Dolalala.
Oh.
But that is more amusing than anything else, and it doesn't do me a particle of harm, so I am you know, unaffected by that. But I believe that Mrs. Madison is generally what I'm known as, and you, I believe?
I haven't heard of Queen Dolalala.
Well,
and I categorically decline to consider what others might call me outside of my presence.
Yes.
But in my presence, I too am comfortable with Mrs. Monroe, since we are first and foremost private citizens.
Certainly, yes, well, that's a good thought.
I will certainly respect your feelings in that regard. I do point out, Mrs. Monroe, that there was a time when our French friends across the water referred to you as La Belle Americaine. So you certainly inspired the adulation of those masses. I think if it's not considered too impertinent, I'd like to put up for possible consideration the term First Lady. Perhaps it will catch on at some point. I do think that it helps embody the fact that you were the wife of the first magistrate, the first consul, if you will, of our republic. So perhaps think about that
There's
one for a while.
There's some ground to that, as you say. Although, you know, we're not necessarily hierarchical within the ladies, it's certainly a term that could easily be used and would not confuse anyone, which I think is paramount.
And it's much easier to say than
Lady Presidentress.
Yes.
You have to be very careful about your enunciation.
Yes.
I will decline to try to attempt to say Lady Presidentress without covering you in spittle, which would not be elegant at all.
So I believe we're sitting far enough away.
We will move on from that one.
The purposes of our evening. Yes.
But apart from titles, I do wonder if both of you might be able to reflect upon and maybe share with us how the arc of your husband's careers before the presidency affected your role. Obviously, you are, in each case, the wife, the helpmate, if you will, of your husband. You are the executive, if you will, of the family life in many ways. But did your role in supporting your husband through their long political careers change at all once they attained the presidency, or did it stay substantially the same? Mrs. Monroe, I'll throw that one to you first, if I may.
Well, Mr. Monroe has been in the service of his country since the beginning of our marriage, so I've always been the wife of a politician, whether that is a congressman, a governor, mm-hmm. a diplomat, secretary of state in war most recently. So it's familiar territory. But I would say the expectations in Washington are quite different than what we've experienced in the past. So we're adjusting to that, although with Mr. Monroe's presence as Secretary of State here in mm-hmm. the city under Mr. Madison's administration, we're familiar with the nuances. But it certainly does require a bit of adjustment on our part.
And also coming back from France as well.
Yes.
I was just thinking, as you asked the question, that we were able, as it were, to practice when Mr. Madison was Secretary of State. Mr. Jefferson was not a person who entertained very much, and so a lot of the, if I can call it, social life centered around our house in F Street. And that was convenient because I could also, when Mr. Jefferson's daughters were not in the Federal City, he would often ask me to act as hostess if he was hosting female guests. And I was always perfectly happy, among others, to go over and do that. But it gave me a way of gauging how to get people talking about other things than politics, because you know being married to a politician means that you might get politics for breakfast, lunch, tea, and dinner. And I'm not entirely sure it's healthy. Now, Mr. Madison has a wide fund of conversational topics, so he was not, subjecting me to all of this political talk, and I am very interested in what Mr. Madison does and thinks. But I know that Mr. Jefferson's habit was twofold. He only invited all Federalists or all Democrats, the Whig Party, and he didn't mix them, which was very good that there was no dissent, but it also meant that conversation could get very weighted. And what we were hoping for is a more mixture of things. And that is why when Mr. Madison became president, I started at the Executive Mansion, I started doing Wednesday night just receptions. And if you had been introduced to me or to Mr. Madison at any time, you could come. And it's not hard to get introduced to either
not
of us.
Not in the Federal City.
Not
and
in the Federal City.
Those when the season begins
very
again
good.
In October.
Yes.
We find that that's very effective to
yes.
allow the city the accessibility that they seem to desire of the president.
It's better to do it on your terms, to open
yes.
it up on a
very
night that
much.
You choose, than to have people coming in to your breakfast table. That happened once.
Yes.
Someone just came in and thought the Executive Mansion was a public building, which in a sense it was, but I prefer not to meet guests until a little later in the morning.
Mr. Monroe has been frequently called away from dinner
yes.
as of late to answer
yes.
visitors, so we've decided that he will have set receiving
yes.
hours
yes.
during the daytime.
During the daytime,
we
yes.
certainly want him available.
You touch on something I think that it's important for us to remember, that we are a young republic. We are not possessed of a long tradition of court customs and styles. In fact, in no small part, our revolution had to do with the rejection of some of those trappings of royalty. And yet, there is a certain tone, a certain style that perhaps can be defined for the leader of our nation, the leader of mm-hmm. his respective party, should we continue to evolve into political parties, and also for a way of conveying a sense of this republic and what it stands for to the outside world, to the foreign emissaries, to both our friends and foes abroad. And I think, Mrs. Monroe, when you and your husband have had to contemplate and confront, really, the considerable task of carrying on what the Madison started in rebuilding and refurnishing the White House after the visit by the British Army in 1817, what has that done, or how does that relate, I guess I should say, to the sort of tone, the sort of projection that you want to make of the President's House and his administration, Mr. Monroe's administration?
Well, we certainly want it to be a place that doesn't project the monarchy, of course. We would be horrified to see that. But we certainly want it to project that sense of formality and grandeur that would encourage respect and consideration, especially from foreign visitors, from the ministers. You call them diplomats now, is that the case?
It's starting to come into vogue. I think the Dutch have introduced
consuls,
the term possibly.
Consuls, yes. So familiar faces from overseas that we would like to take an impression back with them. That there is more to the federal city than the construction that we see
yes.
throughout. So we are looking to project that image without slipping back into where we've come from.
I'm led to understand that in his instructions to buyers in France, Messrs. Russell and Lafarge, mm-hmm. that the president, Mr. Monroe, made it clear that he wanted to acquire articles of the best kind.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I think that going to France primarily, as well as to using English and American craftsmen, are aimed in that to that end, to
yes.
try and depict some of the grandeur of the United States and what should be projected in the President's House. So I think it's a lofty goal. I do wonder, and we have talked a bit about what the two of you in approaching the respective administrations, the tone, if you will, that's set. Mrs. Madison, particularly because you really were among the earliest to encounter this, the Society of Washington being a very new federal city, literally being carved out of the wilderness, and in some ways still being so. How have the changing circumstances or dynamics, if I can use a modern term, of this city affected your role in terms of being part of your husband's family and administration and in society?
Well, I think that part of our desire, Mr. Madison's and mine, was to get the city working as a city, not just a political capital, because what we wanted was people coming and staying, not just for the congressional term, but investing in businesses, you know, starting businesses, hiring people. And one of the ways to get that is to get the families of congressmen to come. And for a while, they were, you know, the congressmen would come down for the season, for the term, and they would stay in boarding houses, often segregated by politics and even by state. So, for example, yes, all the New York Republicans would come and stay in one boarding house, and all of the, you know, people from North Carolina would come up and they'd stay in another boarding house, and their circle was very restricted, and they didn't have, you know, friendly conversation to sort of smooth some things over. And that is one of the reasons we started entertaining, and why I went out calling upon any congressman's family who came down, because it's not a comfortable city, really, not yet. It's certainly not what you're used to in Paris. But if I could go and, you know, they could write back to their friends back home that Mrs. Madison came and stayed 20 minutes and took tea with us and, you know, explained how to order, you know, a cake. You know, there are confectioners in the Federal City now, which is, I think, a great mark of luxury.
Mr. Arden.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes, he has provided us with some wonderful
that
confections for us.
Very good to know.
Yes.
Very good to know. But I mean, it's that sort of thing that people coming down and trying to start to live in the city and not just visit, you have to make them welcome. You have to perhaps go a little bit more. And one of the things I started doing was holding dove parties, and you were smiling, but that allowed women to talk about what their husbands were doing or, you know, certain questions they might have. And then I could engage them in more charitable objects, like the, I was the first directrice of the female orphanage, a very big problem of poor young girls whose parents had died and might not necessarily have anyone able to, you know, adopt them into a family. And we had to make sure that they were set to trades and fed and housed and, you know, clothed and all of that.
Certainly. And now, and based on your work, the city of Washington has established well, but it's seeing its growth that you could not imagine.
Mm-hmm.
10 years ago,
mm-hmm.
But it's more than tripled in size. Did you realize?
Really?
Yes.
No, I had not.
It's more than tripled in size.
Population or?
Population, permanent residents throughout the year, more of the families
mm-hmm.
are coming,
mm-hmm.
as you say, although
yes.
the families are still returning home. We'll,
mm-hmm.
I have hopes that in the coming seasons we'll be able to extend that more. But we're seeing a need to help encourage better expectations.
Yes.
From the standpoint of the protocol, the
mm-hmm.
etiquette, the,
mm-hmm.
the expectations, especially from the diplomatic corps.
Yes.
We want to know that the way that our foreign ministers are received in their host
mm-hmm.
countries is the way that those
yes.
countries' foreign ministers will be received here.
You are reminding me of the Mary incident.
Oh, dear.
I've never heard anything so ill-called.
Oh, dear.
President Jefferson, if I may remind you of this, had... Would you call them very liberal philosophical ideas?
We can use that, yes.
And he did not believe in hierarchy. I think some of this was the time he spent in France.
It's possible.
It's possible.
We haven't brought that.
You have. No, I understand that. But he said, instead of all of this etiquette left over from President Washington and Lady Washington, and I have to explain that the way Lady Washington would receive at her parties is they were very, very formal. She and the general would be standing on a platform, and you would be brought up to bow and curtsy and make a few comments, and then you would leave the platform and go stand with everyone else. And that did not seem... You know, it seemed pretty hierarchical and formal to us, as the Washingtons were. But Mr. Jefferson said, no, we will do none of this. We will not have precedence at dinner. And this was very scripted. You know, if you went out to dinner as a husband and wife couple, there was definitely a ranking order, who was the, you know, who was the highest ranking lady, and then the highest ranking gentleman or the host would take her in, and then it all, you know, everyone paired up. And Mr. Jefferson said, no, we're not doing that. We're just walking in and sitting down. There's none of this pairing off like Noah's Ark. So the reason this is an issue is the Marys, Ambassador Mary from England, brought his wife, Mrs. Mary, who unfortunately let it drop that she was going to show the Americans how society should happen. And Mr. Jefferson takes as well to that as anyone, which is to say, not at all. And so at the dinner welcoming them to his post, Mr. Jefferson took me in, and everyone else paired up, and then Mrs. Mary had to walk in to dinner on the arm of her husband. And this sounds so nothing,
but it was a scandal.
Mr. Mary wrote back to London complaining of his treatment, and then we had to say, well, Mr. Jefferson wants pell-mell, and then he explained it to everybody, and it just kept, you know, sort of growing and growing and getting more ridiculous, and it was as good as a play, as I often say. But, you know, finally, you know, they would not go back and eat at the executive mansion with Mr. Jefferson, but they would come to our house in F Street. And so we gradually, I mean, Mr. Madison had to, he might have had to have written to your husband, but he said, I'm appalled that I have to write such trash to you, because it's ridiculous, people arguing about who goes into dinner on whose arm. But this was something that they were very concerned about, and they felt insulted.
They did, and we've been on the receiving end of this from our time in the diplomatic corps. We were in France on two occasions, and in England for a number of years when Mr. Monroe was a minister. And we see how big a difference this attention to detail can make,
yes,
especially to foreign powers. It seems like a small thing, but it's important to consider. And so we are moving to bring maybe not quite the same level that Lady Washington did, but we are seeking to bring more predictability to our drawing rooms and to our events. People need to know what is expected of,
yes,
them and what they can expect of us.
I think that's very important, because there's nothing so, oh, what's the word? So relaxing to one's feelings and to make people sparkle and be better if they know what is going to happen and not think, oh, maybe the president will be answering the door. Mr. Jefferson did that.
In his
slippers.
Yes.
And I know that the audience is shocked into silence hearing this. But
I think they're overcome with consternation at the thought.
I can lend my fan to anyone who needs some extra. But we were still doing a great deal of experimenting.
I will say,
okay, we do not want to do Mr. Jefferson's style, because we ourselves are more formal creatures than that. We like to have breakfast to ourselves. But we're not as formal as the Washingtons. And so what worked for us was the Wednesday reception, so that Mr. Madison could, you know, anyone who wanted could talk to Mr. Madison about things, or just talk to other people. But if you have plenty of food and drink and some mild entertainment, people are very happy to stay.
They are.
Mrs. Monroe, if I may venture into what could be I don't want to appear indelicate in posing this question, but there's been some thought that your health has been a challenge in terms of having a somewhat delicate constitution and having to face the rigors of the very social expectations that you're outlining here. And has that been a problem for you? And if so, how have you confronted that in your role as the president's wife, the first lady, to use that emerging term I'm trying to push?
I can work with the first lady there. Well, as you say, I would certainly not be so indelicate as to go into details of it. But I have accommodated how we interact with Washington society to include my preferences, my health, my family's needs, and the city's needs. So while I am not spending many hours engaging directly with the families, as Mrs. Madison does so beautifully, I would much rather have them come to the executive mansion, to the president's house, for our weekly drawing rooms and engage with us there, rather than to exert beyond what we need to do by traveling for many hours every day. But I would also remind you that Washington is hardly a healthy city.
Especially in the season we're approaching.
It is the migraines or the terrible weather. So I think perhaps Washington society believes that my health is a bigger concern than it might actually be.
I think that message was received, or certainly hope it will be. Did it prove, and this here again, I'm straying into perhaps an awkward spot, but that's the role I've been assigned.
We'll forgive you.
You and Mrs. Madison, and certainly your husbands, have had a long association, certainly before their entry even into national politics, but at the state level. And then as their careers evolve, the interaction between you on both official and personal levels continued to develop in different ways. And so you're very familiar with each other's pasts and with experiences, and your families have had interaction. Did that help you, Mrs. Monroe, succeed Mrs. Madison in the role of sort of first hostess, if you will? Because I think it's fair to acknowledge that
first
Mrs. Madison, indeed very much because of the conscious effort to change the tone of the president's house and its style and its entertaining, set quite a pace. And I think it's easy to say that, and I wonder whether it proved a challenge for you, or did the relationship you had help make that easier to adapt to?
It did adapt fairly well on my part. I believe that society is still adjusting to my preferences and what we hope to accomplish. But yes, as you point out, Mrs. Madison and I have known each other for many years and have great respect for each other, but I don't think you could find two naturally different temperaments if you looked harder.
Two more naturally different temperaments.
Exactly. So my hope is that as not only the families, but the congressmen, our foreign ministers, I hope as they adjust to having Mr. Monroe in office and me with him as well, that they will understand that the differences are not a critique of each other.
Not
and I
all.
Hope they will understand too, hearkening back to our earlier point, that the city is very different and what was best for it.
Exactly.
And Mrs. Madison's accomplishments will be very different mm-hmm. from my accomplishments to encourage the best results that we can.
Times change and
they
we must
do.
Change our circumstances to meet them.
They do.
In fact, that reminds me that it was, I believe that only people who have been president and first lady, to use your term, can really know what it's like.
Yes.
To be in that situation. And you know, as when Mr. Madison became Secretary of State, he gave me a wonderful piece of advice, which was to so order my conduct that I would never become the target of my enemies or, you know, needing sympathy from my friends. And
that's a tall order in politics.
I would argue that a
very
might possibly not
yes.
be realist.
Well, no, but it was one of the best compliments I ever received was when someone said, I am a political opponent of Mr. Madison's, but when I'm at Mrs. Madison's receptions, I feel that I am one of her best friends. And they could never tell from my behavior whether I counted them as supporters or opponents of my husband, and that is difficult to do in Washington.
It is. Discretion mm-hmm. is an absolute necessity, especially, and as you mentioned, with your interactions under Mr. Jefferson's
yes.
administration, and then, of course, with your husband's, there is certainly an expectation that we are a conduit to our husbands, and I have had to work very hard to ensure that people understand that is not the case.
That is very difficult because I'm assuming you're the receive the same kind of letters, which is please help my cousin get a government position. My brother would like to be post office lead or whatever the position is. And all I can do is give them to the person in charge of that, because I certainly don't make appointments like that. The only thing I can do is say, as I did for one of Mr. Jefferson's relatives, is that I believed him to be very talented and very suited to the post. But even Mrs. Adams wrote me. I'd never met her. You know, that was a little oddity, I always
yes.
thought, but never met her in person. But she said, I am persuaded that you will be able to help my relative get a position, and, you know, laid out what he was looking for. And I thought to myself, if there's one thing I never thought of the wife of a former president would be doing, would be writing to me. But she did. But yes, it's very awkward because, you know, sometimes, you know, my disposition is to be helpful. And in all ways, you know, we want the government to employ the best people. Mm-hmm. We want good people to get positions. And then we have circumstances of want and distress that we want to relieve. And so it is very difficult sometimes to know what to do. And as I said, it's you know, I got my fair share of those letters.
Oh, yes.
Yes, very
oh,
hard yes. to know what to do.
But while not responding, it gets perceived as a,
yes.
a lack of concern or
yes.
an unwillingness
yes.
to be
and
concerned as opposed to...
You and I share many, many Virginia connections.
We do.
Yes.
We do indeed.
I must say that I find the idea that anyone would trade upon the potential of influence through a politician's wife or acquaintances to be shocking. I hope that doesn't catch on in our political system.
One of the issues is it's so new. The federal government is still relatively new, and we talk about, as it were, codifying society. We're also doing that with the government agencies, mm-hmm. and they are trying to find out what do they need? What supplies do they need? What people do they need? Surprise, do they need translators and interpreters?
Oh,
I mean, yes, there's many considerations. So I think it was a natural impulse on many
it
people's
is.
Parts. It's not that we hold the power of appointment, but we can forward. And I think that we were seeing it as almost a charitable interest.
Speaking of things that are new and continuing to go through an evolution, if you will, I want to touch on the inaugurations, the first inaugurations of each of your husbands, either both the President Madison and President Monroe, because each has its own peculiar aspect in a way. Mrs. Madison, you had charge, really, of the first
yes.
inaugural ball in
yes.
this new federal city. We,
yes.
of course, had previous capital in New York, and we had been back in the Confederation of Philadelphia, but in terms mm-hmm. of under our federal constitution, it fell upon you
yes.
to have the first opportunity to do something like this. What was that experience like?
What fun. Certainly the largest party I've ever had. But it was delightful. It was delightful. We had about 400 people. It was so crowded and so hot that some people had to break glass of the windows to get any air in. The band played. I think I enjoyed it a great deal more than Mr. Madison, however. Mr. Madison does not like crowds. He does not shine in crowds, and he was looking a little shredded. It was interesting that Mr. Jefferson came. We were not anticipating he would agree, so when he showed up, we were extremely honored. But he said he had not been to a ball in 20 years, if not more. And I thought to myself, yes, but you're here. No, I mean, I believe that it was absolutely fantastic. And if I must say of my own attire, I think I combined what everyone expected, since you've been talking of people's expectations, because they wanted something fashionable. I knew I had to be distinctive as the First Lady, but I wanted to strike a note of Republican modesty. I know that Mrs. Mary, the wife of the ambassador, was sent home from a party once because she wore all of her diamonds. And two men, I still think this was very rude of them, but two men said, "You should not be wearing those diamonds here in America." I'm not sure I understand their thinking, but they sent her home. They wouldn't let her into the party. I that whole situation was very odd. But I wore buff velvet and a turban, a lot bigger than this one. And it was just very plain, but you could definitely tell that I was the wife of the president. Yes.
Well, 8 years later, the situation was somewhat different for Mr. Monroe because the Capitol had been ravaged by the attack by the British, even though 3 years before the rebuilding was still going on. And mm. Mr. Monroe didn't have the benefit or the opportunity, really, to have his inauguration indoors?
No.
Hey.
It was outdoors, and fortunately the weather held fine and accommodated the crowd that was there to celebrate with him. He was very pleased, of course, mm-hmm. to be
of
so
course.
Honored in the election and to receive the trust mm-hmm. of his country.
And as we noted earlier, because of the task of refurnishing the White House, I've heard the term White House brought up lately. I think even in Mr. Jefferson's time, it was starting to be used. I'm perhaps being a little too informal. I should say the President's House.
The President's House
is usually that mode.
Yes,
I think
when
it's
I see
far
it
more common. But the President's House was something of an empty shell to a certain degree, and it compelled your family to employ your own furnishings, really, to keep a household. Did it
we
not?
Did. We immediately began the process of attempting to obtain the furniture from France to quality that we felt was necessary for the President's House and for the image we were hoping for. But we had been residing on I Street, a lovely townhouse there. And so we brought our own furniture to the White House, as you call it, to the President's House until that furniture from France could arrive. Though fortunately, we didn't take up residence there until the fall after Mr. Monroe returned from his tour that he completed to the north.
That tour, by the way, I think had a very, very positive effect upon the start of Mr. Monroe's administration.
It appeared to.
I believe a phrase was even coined.
On him.
Yes.
The phrase "era of good feelings" was coined by a local newspaper in describing it.
I did see that in the newspaper.
One might almost consider that a watchword for the presidency, perhaps.
One could.
We didn't have that until after the Treaty of Ghent.
There was the
anger about the war, and New England tried to secede, and you know, I was very frightened for Mr. Madison when the Federal City was attacked, because I knew that disaffection stalked. You know, I was all confidence in our army. Misplaced confidence, but confidence nonetheless. But I was just concerned about him because,
certainly.
You know, a man in his 60s, not in the best of health, and he'd never had military service. Not
yes.
like Mr. Monroe.
And yet, he was on the field.
He took to the field.
What?
And most of the cabinet, including mm-hmm. Colonel Monroe,
Colonel
as he
Monroe.
Often still prefers to be addressed,
yes.
were there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a fairly near-run thing in
it
terms
was.
Of their escaping from the approaching army.
And your husband had two jobs at that point, two positions.
He did. He rotated into both Secretary of State and Secretary of War mm-hmm. On two occasions.
Yes.
Thankfully, only for a few months in each. It was a thankless position.
Yes, most of them are.
I have to believe, though, again, hearkening back to the fact that your personal and professional political lives had been so intertwined, really from the point at which Mr. Jefferson first introduced
mm-hmm.
Mr. Madison to Mr. Monroe
mm-hmm.
and began that wonderful three-way conversation, that three-way dialogue that's had such an impact on our nation's development. Five-way, exactly, excuse me. Yes, that's true. and the fact that probably, I would assume, that helped a great deal in both the relationship that the two men had when Mr. Madison was president and Mr. Monroe came in, leaving his last term as governor of Virginia, mm-hmm. practically as it started, to take
that,
up the
yes,
reins
yes.
of Secretary of State, and then to have what seems to be a very smooth and philosophically consistent transition between administrations. I think it probably, I would assume, not just political, but has a personal element to
yes.
it as well.
I was going to say, this just occurred to me, but part of it might be that the result of the Treaty of Ghent, the burning of Washington, the victories at Baltimore and New Orleans,
mm-hmm.
really united everyone so much against the British that a lot of the, if you were state loyalties, dropped away a little bit.
It became less of Mr. Madison's
yes.
war and a celebration
yes.
of
yes.
the accomplishments.
A peace for everyone and everyone seeing the benefits. And also, sort of, as Mr. Madison described it to me, it put paid to the temptation of Canada. And that boundary was set. And so, you know, we sort of looked at, this is what we have, this is what we need to make the best of.
Mm-hmm.
Now, apart from the personal acquaintance and the long trust and involvement.
I think if I'm correct in this story, it may be apocryphal, but I have the two absolute sources, the incontrovertible sources to ask about it. I understand, according to this story, that the two of you, at the point at which the transition of the administrations had occurred, and Mrs. Madison and Mrs. Monroe, you were walking together around the White House as the reconstruction was going on, and workmen were about to throw into a ditch the shards of a large mirror that had been at some point in the White House, we believe perhaps in the entrance hall. And the idea evolved between you to have those fragments preserved and later fashioned into shaving mirrors for your husbands. Now, is this true? Is this a legend? And even if it's a legend, is it at least a metaphor for your relationships?
It would be a wonderful one to note the connection between mm-hmm. our husbands and their very long friendship.
And who knows, if they're out there somewhere, those pieces would be wonderful as a symbol of that relationship.
It's as good as a play.
Excellent.
Yes.
Indeed. I do wonder, I think that as we talk about the experiences that you have had in your lives, as we have heard so many stories, so many wonderful stories surrounding you, there are...
We'll have to be on our guard.
Some that have perhaps been embellished by legend and perhaps could stand the scrutiny of clarification. I'm going beyond the parameters of our original discussion within this gathering, and I hope I will not be upbraided for it. But I'm
only in the most polite terms.
I'm
you
going
would
to,
scarcely know.
I'm going to take a chair. I see I've produced the fanning, so that's pretty good. Mrs. Monroe, during your husband's first posting to France, there was a time of great turmoil, obviously, in the height of the revolution of the terror. In fact, just before your arrival, Robespierre, who had been one of the leaders of the revolution, had found himself on the wrong side of the mob and had been beheaded.
Yes.
There was still in the air a great sense of retribution against those perceived as being of the elite or having been tied to the previous governments, including Adrienne de Lafayette, the wife
yes.
of the Marquis de Lafayette, the great friend
yes.
of your husband and great friend of this country, who is himself a fugitive at that time, was being held.
He was in Austria at that point.
Yes, exactly. And it is told that there was a gesture on your part, I'm sure, in consultation with Mr. Monroe about how there might be an opportunity to have some influence upon
yes.
the French authorities in addressing Mrs. Lafayette's fate. Should be held in mind that her mother and sister had already been beheaded, and she herself was very much facing that fate.
And had her children with her, too.
And right, and there's great concerns with for children. Mm-hmm. I don't ask that you necessarily confirm or deny this, but I do wonder if there is anything you can share about it and what it meant in terms of what our country and what your husband's and yours roles with the French really were like at that time.
Certainly. Well, as you mentioned, Mr. Monroe has been friends with the Marquis since their time in the Revolutionary War, as we now know. So he was certainly concerned to know that somebody so close to the Marquis was in danger. We were quite concerned for it. But we didn't want to interfere directly with the climate at the time, especially as you say, we arrived at quite the height of it. So we let it be known that we were concerned for Madame Lafayette, that she was a good friend of our families, and I made sure to pay a visit to her. In her confinement, and then Mr. Monroe worked for many months to help secure her release quietly, but we were able to accomplish that over time.
I think it speaks well to the ability to, if you will, read the situation
yes.
and respond accordingly.
Yes.
And it's true that Mrs. Lafayette had been through several different changes of location and
yes.
would have more. And
mm-hmm.
yet that intercession at that time and in the way in which it was done, I think showed an adroitness of reading the political situation, the diplomatic situation, and a good exercise of the good offices his ministry to France.
Yes, we were very happy for the outcome.
It certainly provided a wonderful opportunity for you to have an influence on those events, and I think it's...
We're always pleased to extend our help to our friends.
Certainly appreciate it.
You know, I've always admired your considered courage. I know that I am often applauded for rescuing the portrait of General Washington.
Why, Mrs. Madison, you anticipated my next topic.
I am astounded. No, but you did that deliberately over a period of days, weeks,
yes.
months.
Yes, it was more appropriate to
and
the situation.
Yes, and you decided, you subdued your own feelings to yourself and may not have done exactly what you wanted to do, but what needed to be done for her, and I've been such an admirer of that. As I said earlier, I was all confidence in the Army, and I was only worried about Mr. Madison. The mayor came to me twice to get me to leave the president's house, and I was, you know, I said, no, I'm still waiting for Mr. Madison. He'd gone to the field of battle, and I wanted to make sure that he was home safe. I didn't want to be separated from him. And at that point, you know how it is when you are packing and you keep walking around the house and you think,
maybe
well, I'll
this.
Take this and
maybe
I'll take that.
That.
The only thing Mr. Madison had asked me to take was the cabinet papers that showed the history of the federal government. Mm. You know, the laws, the statutes, the things that had been concerned in the founding. And so I had packed those, I had packed the silverware, I'd picked up a couple of books, a clock, the crimson velvet curtains from the salon.
Mirrors.
Yes, the shaving mirrors. And then it dawns on me, the portrait. I can't let the British have the portrait.
No.
And so, you know, we're trying to get it down. We have to resort to a great deal more violence. The two gentlemen from New York, thank heavens, show up. We get it down. We shove it into their keeping. I never found out where they did take it. It just sort of vanished. And at that point, you know, it seems like the British are half a mile away, and finally, you know, they're pushing me into the carriage. And so we go to Georgetown, we go west to Georgetown, and everyone is in the road. Horses, carriages, carts, wagons, stray dogs, people just running. And it's, you know, we stayed for a bit with the Norses, but then, you know, Mr. Madison had said, if you have to leave, go to Virginia, get yourself into the farm,
yes.
into the farm country.
Yes.
And I went over there, and I was out of my mind with terror, not for myself, but for Mr. Madison, because I did not know where he was. And so those are, I believe, the worst 3 days of my life before we were reunited on the banks of the Potomac.
Yes.
You know, and he said, wait a few days and then come into the city. And once I had that direction from him, I was completely calm. It was being separated from Mr. Madison that I did not like. But
that is unpleasant.
But the more I looked at it, the reaction, we had invested so much of our time and our love for the city and its people, and to see the great damage only to the public buildings, but still.
Fortunately only to the public buildings.
And you speak of wanting to impress foreign governments, foreign countries. I did hear that the British who went into the Capitol building were very complimentary about it before they burnt it, and the Library of Congress. You know, thank heavens Colonel Thornton begged that the Patent and Trademark Office be spared, you know, by having to appeal to self-interest, but... It was very daunting. I was not in spirits for a long time after that. It took a couple of months, and the great victories at Baltimore and New Orleans helped a great deal.
I think
it was memorable in
yes.
so many ways. This is part of Mr. Monroe, as I mentioned, had gone to the north this past summer to inspect the fortifications.
Yes.
And to ascertain where weaknesses were in the fear and in the event of another issue, whether it's with Great Britain or with somebody else.
Yes.
It was certainly a time of great concern.
I think you did, though, establish beyond a shadow of a doubt that no matter how difficult things get, they're always better when you come back to Virginia. where the love and the warmth of family and familiar territory can You might almost say that Virginia is for lovers.
Well, I would say it's a veritable Eden. Mr. Madison and I are very, very happy at Montpelier. We have
a wonderful home.
A wonderful home. We have
to visit later.
20 people for dinner every night. We suffer no dearth of company. But if it were, now my only task is to get a wife for my son, Payne. He's charming. He really is very charming. He's got exquisite manners. He was on Monsieur Gallatin's peace treaty to Ghent, and he was enjoying the travel. I envy you your ability to, your having gone overseas and traveled, but he didn't come home for 6 months, 9 months, something like that, because he was enjoying meeting people and going to the capitals and having dinner parties for his friends.
It's a wonderful experience.
I thought so, but it's time that he settled down, so I am keeping my eye open for a wife for him.
Well, as you say, as I've had the occasion to see for myself, Montpelier is a wonderful estate. Mm-hmm. And Mrs. Monroe, your family's home in Highland is also quite interesting. I have some trouble really defining the size of it. I guess it depends on the angle to some degree.
It depends on the angle.
It's a very intriguing property.
Always making improvements to it.
I guess the more one looks, the more one sees, I suppose. There, yes.
True in so many senses.
Indeed. Well, we are going to, with your permission, take a short intermission to allow you ladies to refresh yourselves. And I believe that the audience, who has given you their kind attention thus far, may wish to pose some questions. And if you're amenable to that,
we
will
very much
resume in a few minutes to do that.
Certainly.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We are back, and our audience has provided a few questions. We're supposed to Mrs. Madison and Mrs. Monroe, and actually I will begin with Mrs. Monroe. This question from a young man named Bob, which I assume is short for Robert, or perhaps Roberto.
I bet he's a troublemaker.
I get a strong sense of that, actually. You can get a certain aura.
All the other Roberts I've ever known have essentially been troublemakers.
Yes. So.
Robert Livingston.
Wouldn't surprise me at all.
That man should have his hands cut
off.
Are we
sure that's not who it's from?
No, I don't believe so. This looks to be an Eastern European name, but we're not going to use.
No. Just the question.
And it's a rather personal question.
Administration
betrays a certain knowledge of you and your husband earlier in your life. The question is: you lived in Fredericksburg for a few years in the 1780s. What did you think of the place? Obviously, a somewhat uncouth, callow youth in his phraseology.
Perhaps a New Englander. He gets right to the point.
Could be. Yes,
I believe that is. Likely correct.
Possibly one who spent some time, though, in South Carolina and it just didn't take. But
possibly.
Anyway.
Possibly. No.
What did you think of Fredericksburg when you were resident
Fredericksburg
here?
Fredericksburg was quite a transition. I am a native to New York in Manhattan. So it was quite a transition coming to Fredericksburg as a new wife. And
that is probably one of the more understated terms you've ever uttered in your life.
I try not to be overly dramatic. In my approach to life, but Fredericksburg has many fond memories for me. We were newlyweds, and that December we also had our first daughter, Eliza, here in Fredericksburg. Mr. Monroe's uncle, Joseph Jones, is a judge in the area, so we were able to enjoy his company and his patronage of Mr. Monroe as he was establishing his law practice here in Fredericksburg. We very much enjoyed the company of Mrs. Lewis. Their home further towards the edge of town.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So it's a busy city. It is not not quite New York, but it was not a terrible start to our new life together. And I remember it fondly.
And knowing that your husband chose Fredericksburg to establish a law practice at the expectation that it would offer more opportunity than some of the other more settled areas that had higher concentrations of lawyers already in place, I think he had an opportunity.
Quite a bit of traveling too, as part of that, which I accompanied him for as much as I could.
Right, and both the cases here in town, the circuit that he would ride, but as in so many other times in the course of his public career, resuming that public career actually impeded his ability to really develop that law practice.
It did.
Fully,
he
did
wasn't
it not.
Able to develop the clientele and the establishment that he would have liked, but he felt that the service
to his country was more important than the financial security that practicing law would have brought us.
Well, we are a better nation for it in so many ways, even if it did come at the...
A man cannot serve two masters.
Indeed.
At the negative impact on your personal economy, so we are grateful. Mrs. Madison, you are both this evening a vision of loveliness, but I have to say that Mrs. Madison has fulfilled expectations with one of her spectacular plumed turbans. Not that you are unknown for having adopted a similar fashion from time to time.
I do wear them on occasion, just not in the rain.
But it's a very classical tiara that you have favored us with this evening.
The laurels of victory.
Exactly, there you go, that's right. But Mrs. Madison, I wonder, and really this is, I think, something both of you could address since you were both in society, certainly, but the question from an anonymous individual, one who wishes to remain nameless.
It's not Robert again, is it?
No, it's not Robert. No, okay. I think we've clearly established we're not dealing with any more questions.
Different handwriting as well. So.
Yes. Did you have to promote or feel that you were to be a fashion leader in your choice of clothing and accessories? Did you even know that others would be looking at you for your fashions? One might almost say, would you consider yourself an icon of fashion?
Gosh, no. I'm vastly complimented. I will tell Mr. Madison about this evening because he will find that so entertaining. Let me see. There's a couple of questions to answer there. I always knew that I would be looked at. I knew that people's eyes would be upon me. Certainly when Mr. Madison moved to the presidency, who looks at the Secretary of State's wife, but when he became president, then I knew that I would be the cynosure of all eyes. And I don't think that Mr. Madison and I ever truly discussed the matter, but I knew that I personally like bright colors. I like to be distinctive, but I don't have, I've never succeeded in getting very far past my bringing up in the Religious Society of Friends or Quakers. And so my dresses tend to be plain. They might be colorful, but they'll be cut very plainly. Also, I'm a comfortable matron, and I cannot get away with the dresses that Mrs. Bonaparte wears, the ones that fit into a reticule, you know, or a pocket, you know. I just can't wear those. But I like to have bright colors. My favorite colors are crimson and yellow, sun colors, things that are, I consider, happy colors. And it is perhaps a good thing that since Mr. Madison, as well as Mr. Monroe, has suffered in his privy purse from the government service, the restrictions of government service, that I could not indulge my love of fashion and design and attractive fal-lals the way I would like. In fact, something happened when Mr. Madison was Secretary of State. I had asked good friends to send me from Paris any little elegant trifle that they found that they could send back easily that would not require a great deal of packing. What I did not know is that there was such a thing as import duty.
Oh dear.
Yes. This was very, very quashing because Mr. Madison had to pay about $2,000 in import duty because I'd never
$2,000. That's
fortune.
A sum most of us will never see in our lives.
Yes. Well, it was.
Which
it
are
was,
nasty,
I'm
British
so
and short.
See,
according to
my cheeks are flushing because I'm so embarrassed. But
we are all flushing for you.
Thank you so much. Your ready sympathy helps me a great deal through this. But no, we were all looking. You know, there were patriotic reasons for what we did. Mrs. Bonaparte wore very French fashions, but they were not approved of. And when I say French fashions, very sheer, very straight, almost transparent, that really shocked society in the Federal City. They were not welcoming toward that. But if you went too far with British fashions, then that seem to show your political leanings as well. And that is where we start seeing a lot of emphasis on what American cloth can we produce? What American styles can we develop? Can we create our own style and not have to copy from either of those? And you know, people follow their tastes and as far as their circumstances allow. But I know that Mr. Jefferson's daughters once wrote me and said, the next time if you see any new fashionable wigs, please get us one, because we're stuck in the country and we can't get anything nice.
Not readily accessible.
Not readily accessible.
Well, for Mrs. Monroe, that you in fact referenced this, that mm-hmm. the ability to travel, to accompany your husband yes. on more than one occasion mm-hmm. to the continent, to Great Britain, afforded the opportunities of acquiring not only household furnishings and other things of that sort, but clothing, accessories, mm-hmm. jewelry.
Yes, and, wonderful jewelry.
And yes, and I think jewelry that from my understanding is a reflection both of good taste, of quality, but also of utility,
yes.
perhaps is the best yes. way of saying it.
As you know, most of the necklaces in my cross is detached at this point, but most of our necklaces have mm-hmm. a cross that we can add to give a deeper...
Like a pendant.
A pendant, yes. A pendant that can be removed so that I can accommodate different necklines without purchasing new jewelry for it. But I think my favorite piece is a lovely amethyst set, and it can be, depending on how you fasten everything together, it can be a bracelet, a brooch, or a choker.
Really?
So highly versatile for, mm-hmm. for what we were able to acquire it for. And I do, and we do have an image we seek to present, especially in our role, as you say, mm-hmm. of First Lady, and it's a very fine line to walk yes. to being well-dressed, but not overly dressed.
That sort of thing. You don't want people to feel that fashion is your sole, you know, concern, mm. but you don't want people whispering, we really should go over to her and, you know, like...
Put her back together,
you know, tuck her shawl properly, things like that, or she should not be wearing that necklace. There are some very rich families in America, and they can purchase jewels that reflect that and pass those down in the family as they like, but we don't necessarily see that with people in government service.
No.
Yes.
Wouldn't
no.
be consistent with the virtues of Republican simplicity.
Yes, as you say.
Good taste, but not the means to necessarily follow through with that taste.
Well, you can have good taste without being bedizened, you
this
know,
is
and
true.
that is something
is
that, you know, I like to see. I think you can be overdressed, and that is not attractive either.
This is.
Fashion is ephemeral, it is somewhat subjective, mm-hmm. beauty in the eye of the beholder, what have you. I'd like to address something perhaps a bit more substantial in terms of its impact on people. This is reflective of another question. It's actually two somewhat different questions have been posed by the same person, again anonymous, and the erudition of the writing pretty much confirms it's not Bob, so I hope we're well past that. But did either of you have causes? Were there specific problems or matters that which you, coming into the role of First Lady, the wife of the President, espoused? Were there ways in which you thought that Mrs. Madison, certainly being a first of peacetime and then a wartime mm-hmm. administration, mm-hmm. or you, Mrs. Monroe, in the wake of that wartime experience and then the rebuilding, were there things that either or both of you felt were worthy of your particular patronage as First
well,
Lady?
I don't know if this is something that you were considering, but Lewis and Clark asked my advice about what kitchen utensils to take. And you know, I'd heard very much about their voyage of discovery, and it was so interesting to think that, you know, pots and kettles that I had suggested were making their way, I hoped, across the country with them.
Quite the long expedition.
Yes, yes. Mr. Madison always made sure that I got an update when they sent reports back. He would, you know, say,
such
oh, by the way.
Such a considerate man.
He really is. He really is the epitome of consideration. And I helped found the orphanage for female orphans in the federal city. And that's a tricky issue because boys you can almost always apprentice. There's a demand for labor in the federal city. And so, you know, you can almost always find work and someone to take care of boys, but girls are different. You have to settle them, you know, properly. You have to take care of, you know, make sure you have a good family. And then you figure out how to set them up in a trade. And so we thought that that would be an important role. I was the first directrice. Mm-hmm. And I think that one of the things I did first was offer some of the clothes, some of the material to be cut for clothes. So that's about what I can think of besides, you know, visiting and keeping people interested in the city.
Mm-hmm. Happy
the
material.
The orphanage continues, mm-hmm. even now, and mm-hmm. is active in the city.
I hope it was happy material. Bright.
I'm not sure I'm capable of buying any other kind.
I would think that.
But it would have been plain because children are hard on stuff.
They are.
Mrs. Monroe, obviously your husband's administration is in so many ways still new and,
very new.
Burdened with the fact that you're living in a working zone, really, mm-hmm. A partially finished home and a city overall that is...
Yes.
Had barely gotten started before mm-hmm. it was set back. But are there things that you feel in your role as First Lady that you can emphasize? Or is it just enough to try and keep household and semblance of order
enough.
Together right now?
It is. We're not only rebuilding the city from the visit of the British, but as we had mentioned, there's this mm-hmm. time of transition that we see, and so we're emphasizing so many differences within the federal city and so many changes in the expectations on our society and them on us that right now we want to keep things focused and moving forward in that way.
And I would say that even without the war, that our focus was very national, mm-hmm. you know, getting everyone working together, and now you've been able to move internationally.
You've been able to look farther afield mm-hmm. because of the work that you did.
More concerned with an international mm-hmm. reputation and how we are presenting ourselves overseas.
So have you had an opportunity, and I'll do this in reverse order, Mrs. Monroe, and then maybe harken back to you, Mrs. Madison. Have you had the opportunity to establish, this is the other part of this question, a sort of a daily or weekly routine? How do you keep track of all the things that you have to manage in a household? One would think you would need some way of reminding yourself of things.
Quite a bit of credit to, I have an ivory memo pad that comes with me everywhere,
mm-hmm.
and I can
what
use
an innovation.
Charcoal to keep a list of it. I also have to give credit to the Commissioner of the Public Buildings, Samuel Lane, who has been helping keep track of the finances for us.
Oh.
He's been,
I hope, scrupulously.
Wonderful. I'm sorry?
I hope scrupulously keeping track of those
finances. I hope so as well. But yes, there is quite a bit of active activity here during the day that we're establishing a routine for, mm-hmm. and here as we're approaching the spring season and deciding how we'll handle the summer. Mr. Monroe seems to want to take another tour, although I think it will be a shorter tour mm-hmm. this year, but that will certainly disrupt the management of the household mm-hmm. with him gone, and with the season ending, of course. So perhaps you should ask me again in the fall when the season begins what our daily life will look like.
And Mrs. Madison, of course, as we said, your husband's administration and everything about your personal life was dramatically and suddenly mm-hmm. turned upside down, to borrow almost a phrase from an earlier time and circumstance, with the events of the summer of 1817, but, or excuse me, 1814, but prior to that, was there a rhythm? I mean, I know that upon moving into the president's house, Abigail Adams was hanging wash for a while and really bringing a sort of a New England domesticity ethic to her approach in that role.
So severely practical a woman.
Yes.
Mr. Jefferson planned the service wings to accommodate some of that.
Yes.
Domesticity.
Yes. Domesticity.
But what was the style of living for your time?
Well, I had a great fun with Mr. Latrobe. Mr. Latrobe and I decorated before the British visited, as you so genteelly phrase it. We had a great deal of amusement planning the decoration. We had the salon in a beautiful sun gold and a crimson parlor. I mean, it was just really striking. And we deliberately tried to get American furniture using American themes like suns and eagles and things like that. And if we couldn't get American made furniture, then we chose English, but the plainest we could find, sure, because we really wanted to make it striking and comfortable and where people would feel at ease with the formality. And unfortunately, that was the victim of the British visit. And so that has been, I mean, we were in lodgings for quite some time. We were staying at the Octagon and trying to reinstall the Wednesday night's receptions. So you couldn't hold balls quite so easily, but we could certainly open the house to people. And that was the perfect indicator. And this is one of the ways I was able to support Mr. Madison. That was the perfect indicator that life in the capital city was going on, that we were not going to move the capital, because that was a very big worry to me personally, because, you know, we encouraged it and we, you know, gotten to know the people in it, and we wanted it to succeed. We wanted the businesses who had invested, the small businesses, the people working, we wanted that to keep going. We didn't want us all to, you know, move up to Philadelphia or wherever. Oh, it would have been a horrible defeat. Just, I think the ructions would have lasted for a long time. Yes. But when we had to move back to F Street, we were able to keep up some semblance of visiting, not quite as intensely as we did before, but we still paid visits, we still had dinners, we still had the receptions, and, you know, government went on. And the associated society around it also kept going. And that I think might have been that continuity, that we're not stopping just because a couple of buildings were burnt. You know, I think that was one of the strengths of the administration.
Well, I wonder whether there are any other questions or perhaps things that were discussed earlier that maybe were not quite audible within our audience halls. I will throw open to our audience any last opportunity for a question or comment. I think I may have something coming by post, Ryder.
The messenger.
That's right. Now that doesn't sound like an idea that would come along for a while. Now this could fill a whole other hour probably, which we don't have. What advice would you give to young women whose husbands are embarking upon a political career? And I'll just go sit down for a half an hour while you talk about that.
Well, Mr. Madison gave you that wonderful piece of advice,
yes,
that you mentioned earlier.
Yes, I'm trying to remember the exact phrase. Do not be slave to the public nor the martyr to your friends. And that means that you have to be able to guard your tongue and your countenance, and you have to be able to treat everybody civilly, even if they're a Randolph. Wouldn't you say?
Tall order.
A tall order, yes.
Some elements of those,
yes,
pieces of advice are easier to follow than others.
Of course. And also, and this is something I developed personally, never desire to know anyone's business. I cannot tell you enough. I don't need to tell you, of course, but
certainly
do not need to know anyone's business. No, that is a great safeguard. Yes, yes, discretion. I'm so sorry. Someone said something, and I was.
What does that mean specifically?
To be discreet, not to reveal necessarily your innermost thoughts or your private opinions to people who aren't necessarily concerned with it, to not tell stories, to not break confidences.
Certainly not to people who are concerned with it.
Not to people, yes. Not to...
The Federal City is not the safest city,
right,
as far as the society goes, because of the intense scrutiny that the First Lady tends to come under.
People look for advantage wherever they can get it.
I think a term, if it has not already evolved from the advice Mr. Madison gave, will soon do so, which one might state as mind your own business.
That sounds very apt, seems to be the direction that would be going.
Well, by way of transitioning.
I beg your pardon, did you have any more wisdom to share about being that? No, I think
discretion being the highest element of value there would be something to consider.
Indeed. Well, by way of transitioning from the trip through time that you as an audience have made to the present day for all of us, I would like to acknowledge before you the extraordinary historical interpreters that you have witnessed this evening, and I will with everyone's permission. I'm going to read their biographies and then ask you to join me in applauding their role. Catherine Spivey has been interpreting Mrs. Madison for over 20 years. She's appeared to great acclaim at Montpelier, at the State Department's formal reception rooms, at Gadsby's Tavern, and at the Octagon's Treaty of Ghent for bicentennial celebrations, as well as at teas at the Rising Sun Tavern and with the Daughters of the American Revolution. She has an enviable wardrobe of gowns and turbans, which we have been graced with tonight, but she does not take snuff nor own a parrot. There are limits to what she will do for
her
art.
There are limits. There are limits.
You may learn more about Catherine's Mrs. Madison portrayal at thedollymadison.com. Heidi Stello's interest in the early American Republic began in high school as a guide at the James Monroe Museum, a role she still fulfills, I'm very happy to say. It's continued for nearly two decades in her work as a scholar with the papers of James Monroe, a nationally recognized presidential research and publication project based here at the University of Mary Washington. Only two letters written by Elizabeth Monroe are currently known to have survived, so Mrs. Stello particularly enjoyed exploring the details of Mrs. Monroe's character and experiences as First Lady as part of the ongoing research of the paper's project. And I might add that with the advent of the James Monroe Presidential Bicentennial, of which we are doing so much programming, it has been wonderful to see Heidi evolve into the role of Mrs. Monroe to our great benefit, and we hope to her benefit as well. So I hope you will join me in thanking Catherine Spivey and Heidi Stello.